Just roughly. I'm not trying to be in your business. Because I want these guys to realize about investments. You buy Wingstop about how much?
You could get one from anywhere from, you know, around 300.
Right. And it gross about what a year?
You know, different times. Difference. You know, let's say when your first year or two when you're putting your work in, you know, just you know, pray to God to break you.
Right. That's real?
Know, yeah. Right. Yeah, but once you get the community involved and they could depend on what you got going on over there. Let's say, for instance, I bought one for maybe $280 that wasn't doing well. I purchased it down in Cutler Ridge, and 3 years later, it earned $1 million in 1 year.
Wow. That's crazy.
And so that was my first million earning store. Mm. And that was one that was actually poorly managed, you know, this and that. But, you know, I got a team in there. We turned it around 3 years later, a little 3.5 years later, it made $1 million in a year.
My uncle always told me something early in my life, which stuck with me, which is that while you're on the journey, you have to disconnect from the end goal, you know? Because if you're just focused on some end goal, then you might get there, but it'll be hard to progress past that because you're so focused on that one destination that it's like, you know, you maybe forget everything in between, and maybe you could have done more in between. He always told me, like, just be here right now, live right now, and do the best you can right now. Don't worry about what that end goal is. It's great to have goals. It's great to have dreams. But it's just like you get too attached to it, and sometimes it could be a self-destructive thing. So, I mean, I just kind of try and progress as much as I can, like right now. Man.
If you got $200 to your name, you got to put your mind in a setting that I'm worth way more than what I got. So that's how I'm going to look at myself.
This what life like when you go hard. This what life like when you commit to something, when you stand behind something, when you believe in something. These some of the things that you can have.
The greatest advice Wayne has ever given me, and it's a constant, it's less of advice and more of a constant reminder, which I love him so much for saying this to me, is, you know, he's always just like, man, please be yourself. Please don't ever try and be me or anybody else.
Work, man, work. Fuck you wanna be on the streets talking about what you do for, and you ain't doing it. Fuck you wanna be in the club looking like you do something for, and you don't really do it. Fuck you wanna stand next to a nigga like me that really do it, and you don't do it. The fuck from by me, man? Feel me? I got a beautiful bitch next to me.
I mean, we live in a society where a lot of people are followers and they can't, you know, make their set opinions. Like, I have friends going to college for stuff that their parents want them to go for, and they're not even happy or anything, but they're just trying to please them. And in the long run, like, I mean, what's gonna be there? Your parents die and you're just stuck there, like, paying debt for something that you didn't even want to learn in the first place. So I just try to tell people to just think for themselves and they'll be way happier in the long run.
Yeah, that's like really my mission statement since day one. Mm-hmm. And I'm getting so worked up talking about this. All I wanted to do was help kids not feel alone, mm-hmm, and stop kids from committing suicide. Because thank you. And I'm never try to be political, and I'm actually like shaking. I can't believe I'm saying this.
Those two specific things.
Yeah, yeah.
Where does that come from?
Well, I dealt with suicide for the past 5 years. You know, like there wasn't a week or a day that didn't go by where I was just like, you know, I want to check out, you know? And I know what that feels like. And I know it comes from loneliness. I know it comes from not having self-worth, not loving yourself. And these are things that, you know, kids don't have music that can coach them and give them that guidance. I didn't have that. I had to listen to Jay-Z and take certain things from it, and then the other I just didn't know what he was talking about.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And like now I'm 30 and I'm like, oh, that's what Hov was talking about.
If I went back and started all over again, I would have focused more on the concept of having patience. I'd have sat down and really evaluated myself, you know, to understand, you know, that word. When I didn't have patience, I was just chasing after the dollar, you know, and that confines me to doing everybody else's music except music I feel.
I find it very interesting that a young guy like you, in this era that's all about celebrity, you don't seem to chase fame at all.
No, I thought I wanted to. Mm. I thought I wanted to, but it wasn't confirmation for me. You know, it wasn't confirmation of success. You know, you get money, And you feel like you're going to buy all these different things and, you know, a whole bunch of stuff. But at the end of the day, you're still going to be unhappy. That's what people don't understand, you feel mm-hmm. me? So I had to find a different type of inspiration and something to live for rather than just how much money I make. You know, mm-hmm. I can't preach this same type of thing to the homie in the hood because he ain't got nothing.
Right.
You know, until he get it, he'll understand what I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. But from the stamp, how can I explain it is, it's always been the root of all evil. People forget that. You know, you could be able to support yourself and your family, things like that, but it brings issues, man.
You agree, Andy? It brings
issues. Money always brings issues. That's why you keep your family tight.
What issues has the money caused for you? Because you ain't the flashy type at all. You keep it low key. You move like a drug dealer, actually. You move like a guy that's really got the weight. You don't want to be seen. Yeah. What issues has it caused for you?
What issues it caused? It caused it made people lose his focus of who you really are. Mm. You dig what I'm saying? Like, simple as this. It could be something so simple. People don't know the industry that we in. You know, mm-hmm. your family don't know. You can explain it to them all you want. Mm-hmm. They'll never get it. All they can do is understand it. I mean, deal with it. Not understand it, but deal with it. Simple as this. I'm doing an interview right now. Somebody can blow me up on a text message 2 or 3 times.
Mm-hmm. You ain't not responding.
I can't answer that text mm-hmm. message.
Right.
I'm busy.
But the moment they trigger their head, okay, he got money. He don't
answer
me no more.
He changed on me, right.
But that's one text message, though. Mm-hmm. So imagine how huge things can change over from a dramatic standpoint.
And, you know, people can write all they want, but what are people doing? And if there's anybody that's out there doing, they know how hard it is to actually do. And I'm like a motivation of the doers. If everything I did failed, which it doesn't, it actually succeeds. But if everything I did failed, just the fact that I'm willing to fail is an inspiration. People are so scared to lose that they don't even try. When this goes online or whatever it is, it really matters and it like really doesn't matter. What matters is, you know, the people who are sparked by it and the people who are like offended by it, it doesn't matter because it's about motivating the doers. And anyone that wants to sit around and talk, they're doing too much time. They're taking too much time talking shit about it instead of getting up off their ass and following their dreams. Because I'm here to follow my dreams, you know, and help other people follow their dreams and inspire people who are dreaming.
Dream, you got some shit you want real bad. You can't wait till this shit come. You think about this shit all the fucking time. You can't wait. Sometimes you get frustrated and a little down because that shit ain't coming fast enough like you want it to. Sometimes you worry, damn, is it gonna come? I'm telling y'all, no overnight, it don't happen like that. You gonna get there, but I'm gonna tell you how you gonna get there. Step by fucking step, that's how this shit work, you know what I mean? Don't get discouraged, just keep putting one foot in front of the fucking next, and that's how it work. I'm gonna tell you right now, LA, to those people you got a dream in here, you still holding on to that shit, you want it bad. I'm gonna tell you like this, listen. If somebody in this room had the magic power where they could snap their fingers, and as soon as they snap their fingers, your dream is gonna be here tomorrow. When you wake up, everything you wanted is here. Just like that, because they snapped their fingers. I'm gonna tell you the truth, LA. You don't want it like that. Trust me. Why do I say that? Because my nigga like, shit, my nigga, I do it. Yes, I do. Yes, I do. I take a million right now, just snap. But this is why I'm gonna tell you that. Because when you really got a dream, you're gonna feel what I'm saying. If you go from 0 to 100, like this. You don't realize it, but what you're doing is you robbing yourself of the beauty of the fucking journey. The journey is the best part, I'm telling you that. The journey is the best part. So when you go from 0 to 100, you're gonna miss out on 27. 27 felt good too, cause you like, damn nigga, I'm on 27. Then you get to fucking 58, and like, damn nigga, I'm all the way to 58. I'm a miles on 0. Then you get to fucking 80, then 90, 95, then you get to 100. That's how you want it. And I'm telling you, it's going to happen like that. Now, I know because I've been through it.
Because when you're in pursuit of perfection, all your moves should be premeditated. Don't let nothing surprise you. Anticipate it. You got to put thought into this shit. Nigga, if you want to reach greatness, you know what I mean? If you want to do something special, if you want to do something unique, or you could go out there blindfolded like 99% of these motherfuckers do and just wish or hope to get lucky. Fuck luck. Ain't no luck. You know what I'm saying? all muscle, all hustle.
I mean, who would have thought a ghetto kid with gold teeth and French braids from the hood would be in Vogue and GQ on the same month, in the same month, at the same time, about the same shit? Who would have ever thought Interview Magazine would have did an 8-page spread? Who would have ever thought Complex Magazine a cover with a gay designer, Jeremy Scott, which was an idol of mine because I admired his fashion and I admired his art since late teen. Who would have thought I would have did that? You know why? Because I didn't let the negativity hold me back. And that's what's holding y'all back, negativity, man. Straight up.
Yeah, that's real.
Don't give a fuck what nobody say. Do what feels right to you. You know who you are. Do you know who you are and be you? And I'm me. I'm happy being me. Feel good to be me right now, man.
I always felt like I could do anything. That's the main thing people are controlled by. Thoughts, their perception of themselves. They're slowed down by their perception of themselves. If you're taught you can't do anything, you won't do anything. I was taught I could do everything. And I'm Kanye West at age 36. So just watch the codes of that. Go listen to all my music. It's the codes of self-esteem. It's the codes of who you are. If you're a Kanye West fan, you're not a fan of me. You're a fan of yourself. You will believe in yourself. I'm just the espresso. I'm just a shot in the morning to get you going.
That's, I'm just saying, like, this nigga, if a nigga asked me, like, shit, how you feel like you took off and goddamn stood out? Shit, I wasn't trying to sound like no nigga. I wasn't goddamn watching no nigga trying to do exactly what nobody is, because, shit, they already... Everybody done seen it already. You know what I'm saying? You gotta come up with something. You gotta be able to create something. You know what I'm saying? Even if it take them 10 years to catch on, and you talk about your own shit, they gonna catch on.
Right.
Yeah, like Drip, they know that. Like I was saying, Drip season one, everybody like they thought it, they were like, what the hell he talking about? What the hell is a Drip? Now everybody dripping.
Right.
Which is cool.
Bro, it's a million and one excuses for a nigga not to get it. If you a nigga looking for excuses, you'll always be able to find them. But over here, that shit is unacceptable. We gonna win. We gonna get it. I remember being a young nigga watching Rob Bass' video he had on that red silk suit. It takes two to make a... Damn. If I could just... God damn that nigga. Nigga, salute to Rob Bass, man. That shit inspired me. Along with a bunch of other niggas, but all I'm trying to tell you is this. If you watching Ricky Rose in the biggest house in the fucking United States of America, you could be 20 times bigger than me. You just can't accept no excuses, because what you got to tell yourself is Rose wouldn't. If we woke up early morning, nigga, every day and said, let's go and get it, and I don't give a fuck what time we go to sleep to.
Faith is just taking the first step. Even when you can't see the full staircase. Like, when you got them.
But just know... that all of y'all watching this right now, y'all the future. You know what I'm saying? So like, y'all the next president, doctors, rappers, beauticians, CEOs, scientists, politicians, all of that. So it's like, it's time to create.
Don't say, man, I would love to get this. Say, I got this. I am a Grammy Award winning artist. I am a multi-platinum selling artist. I am a well-respected artist. I am a doctor. I am a lawyer. I am an architect. I am... you know, whatever you may want to be. I am a painter. You know, just claim it as yours, and it's yours for the taking. And just work. You got to work behind it, too. You got to work like fuck. Like, niggas is lazy now. You got to outwork your competition. Like, no matter what it takes, you got to outwork your competition. Because niggas is working. It's a lot of niggas with the same dream as you. And them niggas is talented, but you got to fucking outwork them.
Whatever you want to do in life, find something that you don't mind doing for the rest of your life. Find something that you like. And even if it seems like it's impossible, it's very, very possible. So don't get nervous. If you have a big goal, just chip away at it until you get to where you need to be. You know, when you a thinker, I'm the same way. When you a thinker, you look for answers that you know you can't, like, you're not gonna be able to get, you know what I'm saying? It kind of drives you crazy. Because you feel like you should have these answers, but you don't. So you just try to think your way into a solution, but you can't find the answer. So, like, I think that's what life is about, truly finding yourself.
There's a line on your record, you say, how long until opportunity
means preparation? Yeah.
I need some real nigga reparations before I run up in your bank just for recreation. Yeah, it's just speaking to like the combo you have with yourself when you outside of the opportunities, but you know your actions and your mentality are success, but the reality of your situation is.
This album sounds to me like a therapy session. It's yeah, in yeah. a sense, have you been in therapy?
Yeah, yeah.
First off, how does Jay-Z find a therapist? Not in the phone book, right?
No, dude, great friends of mine. You know, mm-hmm. friends of mine who've been through a lot and, you know, come out on the other side as like whole individuals.
What was that like being in therapy? What did you talk about that you had never acknowledged to yourself or talked?
I grew so much from the experience. But I think the most important thing I got is that everything is connected. Mm-hmm. Every emotion is connected and it comes from somewhere. And just being aware of it. Being aware of it in everyday life mm-hmm. puts you at such an advantage. You know, mm-hmm. you realize that, you know, if someone's racist toward you, it's not even about you. It ain't about mm-hmm. you. It's about their upbringing and what happened to them and how they led them to this point. Mm-hmm. You know, most bullies bully. Mm-hmm. It's happened. Mm-hmm. Oh, you got bullied as a kid, so you're trying to bully me. I understand.
Right.
And once I understand that, instead of reacting to that with anger, I can mm-hmm. provide a softer landing. Mm-hmm. And maybe, oh, man, are you okay? Mm-hmm. I was just saying, there was a lot of fights in our neighborhood that started with, what you looking at? Why you looking at me? You looking at me? And then you realize, you think I see you. Mm-hmm. You're in a space where you're hurting and you think I see you, so you don't want me to look at you. And you don't want me to see you in such a bone. You don't want me to see your pain. You know, right. So you put on this shell of this tough person that's really willing to fight me and possibly kill me because I looked at you. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Like, so yes. Knowing that and understanding that changes life completely. I think that rap in particular is a young man's sport, that I'll move out of that white hot space. But rap is about the gift of discovery. To be the cool person in school, you have to know the newest music, the newest dance move, have the newest clothing on. Mm-hmm. So rap is based on that. What's mm-hmm. new? I know you know Jay-Z is good, but mm-hmm. do you know this song right here that only 4 people heard it?
Right.
You know what I'm saying? And then they bring that person into the masses, mm-hmm. the pop culture, and then you have a window mm-hmm. before saying that you are the one is no longer cool. And mm-hmm. then you have to move past that. Mm-hmm. And you have to find a way to exist. Mm-hmm. The white hot gotcha. Space is when it's fresh and new and it's like, this is the hottest song ever.
Right.
I mean, I pushed the window like...
you're still in that space.
Oh, I stood in that window a really long time.
And you're still in there?
But still, no. I don't think people are looking to me as like the thing.
They're is that already, hard to deal with? Or did you feel like, I'm okay with that because I've moved on.
No.
You don't want to be.
Because at the end of the day, we're going to find out it's not about the white hot space, but it's about finding the truth. Mm-hmm. That white hot space, people think is the biggest thing, but it's really small. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. It's almost like a trend. Mm-hmm. Would you rather be a trend or you rather be Ralph Lauren?
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, you rather be a trend or you rather be forever. I'm the person that looked at the Mona Lisa and be like, man, that's going to be cool in 40 years.
Right.
Right? I play forever.
Right.
I play forever. And and so my whole thing is to identify with the truth, not to be the youngest, hottest, new, trendy thing.
You know, I be juggling. You know what I'm saying? I juggle a lot. I play a lot of positions. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? So my mentality when I do start to be like, damn, this is a lot. You know what I'm saying? It's just like, you know, that's what it's supposed to feel like. If you are going toward what the vision look like, and that's like greatness. That's, you know, on multiple levels. Mm-hmm. That's the vision that I'm working toward. So I'm like, I just think about that. Like, this shit ain't supposed to feel, you know, comfortable. It's supposed to be mm-hmm. uncomfortable. It's supposed to stretch you. It's supposed to be a burden to a degree. And you gotta, you know, wrap your mind around that and accept it and embrace it, and you catch some wisdom off of that.
All my original goals, I met them. I had goals as somebody coming out the street.
So I didn't have a hell of a entertainment set of goals. I never wanted to win a Grammy. That was not my goal coming out the street. Them is music goals now that I'm in the music game. That was never my goal. I never thought about selling a million records. I thought about, you know, doing something legit to make my money and being able to, you know, not worry about when I heard the helicopter late at night thinking they was coming to kick the door down. Right. You know, I was like, I read an article that Joel Santana made $15,000 a show. I don't know if it was true or not, but I'm like, damn, you can make $15,000 a show? That's how I was thinking at that time. Like, you know, what we did as teenagers to make $15,000, you get a lot of years for it.
Absolutely.
So, you know, you could go do a tour where you make that every night. And then I remember looking at every state, like it's 50 states. If I could sell 1,000 units in each state, indie, at $8 a unit, you know what I mean? I could make somewhere near $500,000 if I just figure out how to do that. And that was my little entry level goal. So, you know, we established and accomplished them things early and had to redevelop my goals. Now that I was in the game and I learned niggas get $1 million a show, niggas get $500,000 a show. I didn't know that. I didn't know that, you know, you got, I knew, but I didn't think that it was realistic that you could really sell millions and millions of records and become a global brand. So as I became exposed to these situations, met these people that performed on that level and like, you know, you ain't no smarter than me. You know what I'm saying? You just in a position. You just, mm-hmm. you know, you sitting in a space where you could execute on that level. You know what I mean? I start reestablishing what my goals were.
See, I guess in this culture that everything is so accelerated, people want to be Jay-Z overnight, you know what I mean? Or the J. Cole overnight, you know, but I know it takes a minute for you to get to that level.
But that's what everything, right? In life, people emulate the end result, not the process. The end result is what they see, and they emulate that. And it's like, you know, these free throws. Before Kobe scored that 61, that day.
You were there?
That day. That day he was practicing. He practiced his whole life. Are you willing to put in that sort of commitment? Are you willing to practice the whole life? You know, Mayweather's running right now, probably.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Are you willing? I'm sure you want to be on a jet and all that, but do you want to put in that work? That's what it takes for something great, that amount of time, that level of commitment. You know what I mean?
I just want to let y'all know that life will throw you a shit ton of curveballs. It's scary. But, like, if you believe, man, you know, if you believe, and if you want it, and if you want to work hard enough for it, it can be so. Because there's no difference from me and you. I just really wanted this shit. I wanted it bad.
Really, I just kept at it. I work. I don't believe in, I hate lazy people. I hate laziness. I just don't like procrastination. I don't like people that make up excuses. Just get it done. And I've always taken that approach with my life and my career. And I guess that's why, you know, I guess that's why I've been around. And I haven't just gotten around, you know. I've been here for a minute. You know, you guys probably know. Yeah. So I've been trying for a long time. And it just goes to show you, like, you know what? If you really want something, you work hard at it. You know what I'm saying? Eventually people will come around. It's just up to you to stick with it. I think the problem is a lot of people just give up because it's so difficult. You know, you want to go and, you know, it's like you got bills to pay. You can't keep on going to the studio. You got to do this. So a lot of people just give up. But I just didn't. I just kept working.
Words into existence. Since the nigga was broke, everything I did today, nigga, I spoke up to existence, nigga. You know what I'm saying? And so I'm living this shit for real.
You gotta talk words. Words are powerful. You got to talk them into existence. Anything negative, you got to disassociate yourself with it and move it further away from you, because everybody that you love, they just don't know what's right for you. You know what I'm saying? And it's just hard for everybody to think the same and explain to what you really want and how you feel. Do the unbelievable, the unthinkable. The shit I couldn't even imagine. I get on my knees and I thank God and I pray for shit. Just take me places I never thought I could go. My furthest imagination, I want to go to those places.
When I was young, I thought that success was all I needed. That's what was going to bring the happiness. Buying my mom a house, being the fame, the accolades, having people say, yo, you are the best in the game. I thought those would be the things that would bring happiness. And then when those things came, the happiness wasn't there, and I realized why that was. There was such an attempt to achieve these things and to keep going that you lose sight of the people and the blessings that you have around you. You're so focused on the next success, the next step in your career, the next check, whatever it is, and you forget the fact that you have these things that seem small if you're looking that way. Mm-hmm. But if you look this way, you realize they're the only thing that matters, and that's your mother, that's your family.